Assalamu alaikum and good morning to one and all. Today we'll start with a new chapter, that is Pharmacoepidemiology. I am Professor Sheikh Abu Sufyan. Welcome you to my YouTube channel, Pharma Learning Forever. At the end of this e-learning session, you are able to explain pharmacoepidemiology and discuss different types or design of epidemiological studies. So let's see the definition and history of pharmacoepidemiology. So pharmacoepidemiology, it is basically the study of use and effect of drug in the large number of population. So we have seen in last session about the clinical trials and the drug discovery process, where we study the effect of drug or use of the drug in limited number of population. So right from the phase 0 study, where we study only the 15 number of the peoples, whereas till the confirmatory study, where we study the effect of the drug in about 1000 number of population, or in case of the 1000 volunteers or the participants. Whereas in case of pharmacoepidemiology, once drug it is launched into the market, that drug will be taken by n number of the people. So when you study those people in a detail and how drug is producing effect when it is given to large number of population, so that type of study, it is called as pharmacoepidemiology. So it is very important study in order to decide about the future of the drug. So earlier, there was no pharmacoepidemiological study, but it was developed after thalidomide tragedy. And we know in detail about the thalidomide tragedy. So thalidomide in the 1960, it was used to control the nausea in case of the pregnancy. So when you give thalidomide for the treatment of the nausea related to the pregnancy, so earlier there was no report of any teratogenic effect. So any effect which is produced on the growing fetus in the mother womb. So earlier no such report was there. But in 1960, when this drug was first time given to the different pregnant women for the treatment of the nausea, then it was observed that there was report of limb abnormalities. So their newborn baby, they suffer from the limb abnormalities, and then it was thought that there is need of pharmacovigilance. So pharmacovigilance, it is the post-marketing surveillance, that is the surveillance of the drug, it is needed even after the clinical trials or even after the launch of the drug into the market. So that is called as the post-marketing surveillance. Okay, so basically in the pharmacovigilance, or in case of post-marketing surveillance, what you are doing is the drug, it is given to n number of people, it is given to the large number of the peoples, and then you study their effect, take the reports which is given by the different physicians, which is related to some unusual effects or maybe some adverse effect related to that particular drug. So this was first time introduced after thalidomide tragedy. So this is about the brief of the pharmacoepidemiology, why it is introduced and what is the need of pharmacoepidemiological study. Let's see about type or design of epidemiological study. So epidemiological studies are designed based on the need of epidemiological study and the type of drug you are studying. Okay, so it is designed into different category, like randomized clinical trial. So it is basically the experimental study. So it is done based on some report that you observed on particular patient. So that is the randomized clinical trial. Second thing, it is the cohort study. Third one, it is the case control study. Fourth one, it is analysis of secular trend. Fifth one, it is the case series. And sixth one, it is the case report. So these are the different type or design of epidemiological study. So we'll start from the last study first, and we'll see the first study at the end. So the smallest study design, which is related to epidemiological study, it is basically the case reports. So the case report, it is the study where simply a report of single patient, it is studied, and it describes a single patient exposed to the drug. So there are two characteristics. First thing is that it is a single patient report, right? And that patient, it is exposed to a single drug. Okay, so when the patient exposed to the drug, or the single patient exposed to the drug, so that drug, it may produce some adverse outcome. Or if that patient, it experienced the adverse outcome which is related to the drug, right? So those adverse outcome can be reported in the form of the case report. So the patient who is the single patient who is exposed to particular drug, and he is suffering from the adverse outcome. So that was earlier not observed during the clinical trial. So if that is the case, then those cases can be reported in the form of the report sheet, and such report, it is called as the case report. So the characteristic of case report is, it is the single patient exposed to the drugs and he experienced an adverse outcome. Okay, so let's try to understand the case report with the help of the case study. So in throughout this chapter, we will be studying n number of case study and try to understand epidemiological study with the help of these case study. So the first case study, it is related to young woman who were on treatment with the oral contraceptive and she suffered from pulmonary embolism. So since she was on treatment with the oral contraceptive and then she was suffered from pulmonary embolism, it is quite possible that, or you can suspect that, the pulmonary embolism, it might be due to oral contraceptive. So you cannot give the statement that it is due to oral contraceptive, but you can say that it is might be due to oral contraceptive, because that reaction, it is seen in that particular woman, which was not observed earlier in the clinical trial. Okay, so this is the one case which is, with the help of that, we can try to understand the case report. Okay, so let's see what is the use of case report study. So it is useful for raising hypothesis about the drug effect. Obviously, you cannot come to the conclusion that the pulmonary embolism, it is due to the oral contraceptive. Why? Because that is study done only on the one patient. So it will only help you to raise the hypothesis or to raise the assumption that the oral contraceptive may produce the pulmonary embolism. Now, if you want to test this hypothesis, then this hypothesis can be further tested with more rigorous study design. So you need more participant to take part in that study where you are giving oral contraceptive and then you are observing what is the effect of the oral contraceptive, does it produce pulmonary embolism in all those population as well. Okay, so the case report only help you to raise the hypothesis about the drug effect and it does not give directly the conclusion about the study. And with the help of this case report, you can raise hypothesis and these hypotheses can be further tested with more rigorous study design. Okay, so this is very important use of the case report study. But there are some limitations of the case report study. So the first limitation is, it is difficult to distinguish whether patient case report or whatever adverse effect that patient suffering from, whether it is due to the drug exposure or maybe that patient is suffering from another typical kind of the disease and due to that disease he is suffering from pulmonary embolism. So this is the limitation. So you are not aware whether, or you are not sure that whether the adverse event which is observed in the patient, whether it is due to the drug exposure or it is due to some inherent disease that patient suffering from, right? So you need rigorous study to distinguish this effect and to ensure whether it is due to the drug or due to the disease. Okay, so this is the important limitation of case report study. A case report study cannot be directly used to make statement about causation. So this I already mentioned, you cannot make the statement that the pulmonary embolism, it is due to oral contraceptive. Why? Because the study, it is done only on the single population or only on the single participants, and single participant has reported that adverse events, and hence a case report cannot be directly used to make the statement about the causation. So one exception to this would be when the outcome, it is rare, and characteristics of the exposure. So what was my earlier statement? So my earlier statement is, case report cannot be used to make the direct statement about the causation. So this exception to that, why? Because when outcome, it is rare, and if it is characteristics of the exposure, means that outcome was not seen in that patient, and that was seen only when that patient took the medicine. So that is the characteristic of exposure to the drug. Okay, so patient has taken that drug and due to the drug treatment, the patient suffer from that rare outcome. So if that is the case, then that is the exception to this. So let's try to understand with the help of the case study 2, where a cell vaginal adenocarcinoma, it is occurring in a young woman exposed in utero to diethyl stilbestrol. So diethyl stilbestrol was given to the mother And the newborn baby, when that newborn baby, when she become a young woman, she suffered from adenocarcinoma. And it was seen in the many patients, since this is the case which is related to the treatment with the diethylstilbestrol, which was given to the mother when she was pregnant, and the newborn baby when she become a young, she suffered from adenocarcinoma. So this is something which is a rare outcome, and this is the characteristics of the exposure. Since it is the characteristic of exposure and it is the rare outcome, so here you can make the statement that the vaginal adenocarcinoma, which is occur in a young woman, it might be due to the exposure in utero to diethylstilbestrol. Okay, so this is the exceptional case. So before going ahead or the second part of today's session, let's have quick question and answer part. So my first question is, give definition of pharmacoepidemiology. Okay, so some of you have already given the answer. So you have mentioned that it is study and use and effect of the drug in large number of the population. Okay, so that is the right answer. So the study of use and effect of the drug in the large number of population, it is called as pharmacoepidemiology. Okay, so you are right. My second question is, enlist type or design of epidemiological studies. Enlist type or design of epidemiological studies. So Kavita has given the first answer. It is randomized clinical trial, experimental study, cohort study, case control study, and analysis of secular trend. Right. Aksa has given the answer. Saqib, Tuba, Rafat. Okay. Then case control study and case series. Zareen has mentioned that about cohort study and case series. So these are the different type of design of epidemiological study. My third question is, what are limitation of case report study? What are limitation of case report study? So we have seen only one limitation of case report study. So what is that limitation? Let's see who give the answer. Limitation of case report study. So I can see the Saqib has given the answer. It is difficult to distinguish whether patient case report is due to the drug exposure or typically due to the disease. Yes, so you are right, Saqib. So the main problem with the case report that you cannot make directly the statement, because it is difficult to distinguish whether patient case report, it is due to the drug exposure or typically due to the disease. Okay, so that is the important limitation of the case report study. And we have also seen the important exception to making the statement about a case report study. Now let's move on to the second part of the session, where we'll see the another exceptions for the directly making the statement about the causation of the disease or causation of the adverse effect is when the disease course is very predictable. So if the disease course is very predictable, then in those cases also you can make the statement, because it is related to exposure of the drug, and if it is happening in that patient, then it is very easily predicted that problem it is happening in the patient, it is due to the drug. So one, it is when disease course is very predictable, and second thing is that the treatment causes a clearly apparent change in the disease course. So we'll see this with the help of another case study. So this is the case study 3. So we already studied case study 1 and 2. So in case study 3, it is related to ability of the penicillin to cure the streptococcal endocarditis. So we know that the streptococcal endocarditis, it is a very severe disease which is nearly fatal in the absence of the treatment. So if you are not giving penicillin, then the patient may die due to streptococcal endocarditis. So what this case study report indicate that when you give the penicillin, the patient it get cured with streptococcal endocarditis. So it is predictable because it is happen after giving the penicillin. So the disease course, it is changed, that patient get cured from the streptococcal endocarditis. So this is the predictable change in the disease course, which is happen after the treatment with the penicillins. So since it is happened after the treatment of the penicillin, it can be easily predictable that cure which has happened due to from the streptococcal endocarditis after treatment of the penicillin, it is directly related to penicillin itself. Okay. So in such cases, you can directly make the statement that penicillin give cure to the streptococcal endocarditis. Now let's see about the case report which can be particularly useful to document causation when there is condition like the treatment causes a reversible change in the disease course. So there you can directly make the statement, or you can directly make the report, or you can make the document where you can say that the particular problem which is happening in the patient, it is due to the drug. Okay, so for that, what is the condition? The treatment causes a reversible change in the disease course, and when the patient returned to untreated state. So what is untreated state? When the drug, it is withdrawal. When the exposure is, if it is withdrawn from the drug, then it can be treated again to improve the patient disease. Okay, so first what happened? When you have given the treatment, that treatment causes a reversible change in the disease course, means due to the treatment that patient disease get cured. Okay, when you have not given the treatment to the patient, then patient return to untreated state, means again patient start showing sign and symptom of the disease, right? So this is the second condition. And when exposure is withdrawn, so when you have withdrawn the exposure, the patient return to the untreated state. And when again you have started the treatment, the again patient condition or the disease, it get improved. So if that is the case, then in such case also you can make the direct statement that adverse effect which has happened, or the treatment which has happened, or cure which is produced by the drug, it is directly related to the drug and it is not related to any kind of the disease or second factor. Okay, let's try to understand this with the help of another case study. So in case of case study 4, a patient suffering from overdose of the methadone, he is comatose. Comatose means he had the patient undergo the coma. Okay, so the patient suffer from the coma. Why? Because he was on the treatment with the methadone, and the methadone, it is a opioid analgesic drug. So it is very strong opioid analgesic, and we know that when opioid analgesic it is given, it produces the depression of the central nervous system, right? And if you want to reverse this, what you need to give, you need to give the narcotic antagonist such as the naloxone. So when naloxone, that is narcotic antagonist, it is given, the patient immediately awaken, means earlier he was suffer from coma, now the patient, it is immediately awaken after giving the naloxone. So it is very suggestive that the drug, it is efficacious as the narcotic antagonist, because patient was undergoing the coma due to overdose of the methadone. When naloxone it is given, that is the narcotic antagonist which will reverse the effect of the methadone, it was observed that there is immediately patient awaken from the comatose state. Okay, so he was not no more in coma, he is awakened from the coma. Okay, now this is happen when you have given the narcotic antagonist, but the effect of narcotic antagonist, it doesn't remain for more time. So when the effect of naloxone, if it is wear off, means the slowly it reduces their effect, the patient will become comatose again, he suffered from coma once again. And then if he or she is given another dose of the naloxone, then in such case the patient will awaken again. So if that is the case, so it is confirmed that the reversible condition of the coma, so patient reverse from the coma, that is due to treatment with the narcotic antagonist, and it is directly related to the earlier my earlier statement where we have seen that the treatment causes a reversible change in the disease course. So disease, it is completely reversed when you have given the treatment, and when you stop the treatment, then it is observed that the patient again return to untreated state, and it can be treated again to improve the patient disease. Okay, so if this is the case, and if it is happened, it means it is confirmed that the problem or the cure which has happened, it is purely due to the drug, and it is not something which is related to the disease condition or due to the pathological condition of the patient. Okay, so this is all about the case report study. The second type of the epidemiological study, it is the case series study. So before going to the case series, let's quickly revise about the case report study. So we have seen in case report, it is done on the single patient and who is on the treatment with the particular drug, right? And the causation, the effect of the drug, it is studied in that particular patient. If that is the case, it is called as the case report study. Second, it is the case series where a collection of the patient are studied, not a single patient. Here you are studying the n number of patients. So it is called as the collection of the patient. So when you study collection of the patient, it is called as the case series. So just to distinguish between case report and case series is that in case report, you have studied single patient. In case series, you have studied collection of the patient. So when you are studying collection of the patient and when you study the effect of the drug in collection of the patient, such study are called as case series study. Okay. So it is studied in the collection of the patient. Another attribute of this study is, although you are studying collection of the patient, but one thing that remains same, it is single exposure. Means that patient is given only single drug and they are often from the single hospital, not from the other hospital. So since they are from the single hospital, the experimental condition remains same and doesn't change. The environment remains same. So it helps you to ensure that the effect it is produced, it is purely due to the drug and it is not due to something which is the external factor. The point to be remembered here is the collection of the patient you are studying, but another thing that remains same as the case report, it is a single exposure, means you have given a single drug to the patient and it is often from the single hospital. So when you study such population who are exposed to single drug and from the single hospital, such type of study, it is called as the case series. So when you are doing the case series, in such cases, the case series can be collection of the patient with the single outcome. Now you try to understand with this, with the help of the case study, here 100 consecutive women which are under the age of the 50. So their age is under the 50 who were suffer from pulmonary embolism. Now, how many women you have studied? 100 consecutive women you have studied. So how it is fitting into the case series? Because it is the collection of the patient. Okay. So it is the collection of the patient. So here the 100 patient you are studying, right? And they were suffer from only single problem. What is that problem? It is the pulmonary embolism. So the single problem they are suffer from, and they were also given with a oral contraceptive. So out of 50 who suffer from pulmonary embolism, it was observed that 30 of them had been taking the oral contraceptive. So what this case study indicates? So this case study indicates that a pulmonary embolism, which was happened in about the 50 women, out of those 50, 30 were given with the oral contraceptive. So this indicates the strong relationship between oral contraceptive treatment and pulmonary embolism. So this is how you can try to understand the case series report. Okay. So after drug, it is marketed. So that is called as the post-marketing surveillance. The case series are useful for two purposes. Now let's see what are two purposes for which we are using case series study after post-marketing surveillance. So first, it is to quantify the incidence of the adverse reaction. So let's see with the help of the example, like in case of phase four, post-marketing surveillance study of the prazosin, it was conducted to quantitate the incidence of the first dose syndrome from the prazosin. So prazosin, basically it is the antihypertensive drug, okay? And it was observed that some of the antihypertensive drug, they produces the syncope. So syncope, it is the very severe decrease in the blood pressure, and that may lead to unconsciousness in the patient. So it was happening, there were some case report about that. So this case report, it is validated with the help of the case series study, where prazosin it is given to the maybe more number of the people, and when all those people, they will suffer from syncope. So it helps you to establish relationship between the prazosin and the first dose syncope that is happened with the prazosin, that is antihypertensive drug. Okay. So it is generally used to quantify the incidence of the adverse reaction. So that we have studied with the help of this case study. Next one, it is also help you to ascertain that any particular adverse effect, it does not occur in the population. Now, how you will ensure that any particular adverse effect does not occur in the population? It is depending upon the nature of the drug. Let's try to understand with the help of the case study, which is related to cimetidine and the metiamide. So in case of phase 4 study, that is the post-marketing surveillance of the cimetidine, it was conducted because the metiamide, which was H2 blocker, so metiamide was the H2 blockers, it was withdrawn after marketing outside the US because the Mitia mite, it causes very severe agranulocytosis. Now the meteomite, it is the H2 blocker. Cimetidine, it is also H2 blocker, and it is also related to same category. Since it is related to the meteomite and having the category of the meteomite, so cimetidine, it is chemically related to the meteomite. So there was a concern that cimetidine might also causes agranulocytosis, because the cimetidine, it is related to meteomite. So if you know that meteomite, it was withdrawn from the market because it produces agranulocytosis, so it is quite possible that cimetidine may also produce the similar effect. So to avoid such adverse effect in the future, you can also conduct a case series study. Okay, so we have seen two uses of the case series study: one to quantify the adverse effect, and secondly to avoid adverse effect in the future, which is related to or which may be happen in case of chemically related substances. So that is, we have seen with the help of the case study of the meteomite and the cimetidine. So I have done with my today's session. So I have referred the textbooks of pharmacoepidemiology by Brian L. Storms, the third edition, the page number 3 to 24. So I must thanks to this author for providing wonderful content on the pharmacoepidemiology. So thanks for watching my session. For more such learning, subscribe to my channel. And if you like my session, then do remember to give me a thumbs up.